Y'all ready? We're gonna call it to order as close to 10 as we can. Try to be efficient. It's 10:05. Okay, we got a delay. Is that Mr. Parks?
Yes.
All right. The clerk is ready. It's about 10:06. And this is Wednesday, November the 28th. And I would like to call this special Finance Committee meeting to order. Roll call, Madam Clerk.
Mr. Mays.
Present.
Mr. Davis.
Present.
Mr. Guerra.
Present.
Mr. Winfrey.
Present.
Ms. Galloway.
Yeah, present.
Thank you.
Okay, that's five present. We have a quorum. And so this investigative hearing will proceed. Do we have agendas? I need an agenda. Let me. Now, this says a special fine, the 28th at 1:15 p.m. That's what threw me off. I'm sorry. I thought this was an old one that the president just left laying there. That's okay. So this, when I go to it, it should take me where I need to go. Okay, I had laid it to the side. Thank you, Janelle. I'll request, I'll deal with any request changes or addition to the agenda. I would request that we change the 1:15 p.m. time to 10 a.m. for the record on this particular agenda. And I would order that without objections. Any more changes or additions to the agenda that anybody see or need? I would ask that we, Mr. President.
No, I just saw what you were talking about. I got it.
Okay.
It takes me a while, but I get there.
Yes, it ain't just on mine. Is it? Mm-hmm. So I would ask that we drop 180568 without objections, but if there are some objections, I don't mind, but we can discuss it at any time. It's always been a part of discussion. That's the one I kind of didn't never want on there. It caused us some time delays last time, but that's neither here nor there. I would order that dropped without objection on this particular agenda. So ordered. Anybody got anything else? I would add a discussion item as it relates to the letter received from the Attorney General order, office in place of 180568. If the clerk, Madam Clerk, do we need any number? Just put it on as a discussion item at this time.
No, not at this time. I should indicate, though, for the record that each council member received a copy in their baskets day before yesterday, as well as by email.
Madam Clerk, thank you and our staff for that. I think that was an important letter. We got notice and got copies in a timely manner. I would like to add that on as a discussion item in the place of 180568. And I would order that without objections. Any objections? So ordered. Any other additional changes or discussion items I would like to add to this agenda? A witness, Mr. Parks, I've asked him to come. He's here. So after the discussion item I just added, I would like to take some witness testimony from Mr. Parks, for one, and I would order that without objections. Any objections? So ordered. Yeah, Mr. Parks, Madam Clerk asked me to indicate for the record where he's from. Mr. Parks is a sworn witness. He's already sworn. I ask that he be continued as a witness, and he's from Goyette, one of the contractors dealing with lead service line replacement as well as restoration. with that housekeeping, I would order that without objection. Any other changes or additions? If not, the agenda would be set, and we would proceed from here. Question, anybody got a time that they need to be out of here? Any of the colleagues? Mr. Guerra?
What time? By one.
By one, we should be out. Ms. Galloway, a time before that?
No, I don't. I just want to make sure that I just thought that this meeting was to see if Amy Etke was going to show up. And so if that's not the case, I guess I would like to know the direction that we're going if she's not here.
We would follow that agenda, and then when we get to the discussion item as it relates to the letter, if we could proceed with the agenda, we'll discuss that as well. And that's why I want to add witness testimony. That's one of the main witnesses who should have been here at request, or we'll get to that legally and see. But no, we've got more business than that. All right. If we proceed with the first discussion item, we always have kept on here and will continue to keep on here rules and procedures for conducting this investigative hearing. Anybody got any communications, discussions, or wishes as it relates to that? Based upon how we've been proceeding so far. Okay, we would then quickly move down to the next purpose of the investigative hearing. Is regarding the flow of funds received by the city of Flint from the federal government and the state of Michigan regarding the city's water crisis. And that includes, and I've always said we would allow leeway, that includes the predictive models, anything we're spending money on. That's why I didn't think we need to spend all of that time last time on that discussion item. And if you notice the witness, Mr. Wong, he talked about it in his presentation after he was able to proceed. And as me and the city attorney talked, and I would say to this council, when a witness talk about something, it opens the door. As we call witnesses and they testify and talk, we don't have to vote to keep expanding the scope. They will allow that inquiry in a legal sense by opening the door. And so we've got good legal counsel here. Yeah, we'll see if we give our legal counsel at the end of the day A, a B, or C. I don't expect nothing lower, but I think they're above average. And then saying that, let's go to the discussion item as it relates to the letter. I've had conversation with Attorney Wheeler. I've had conversation briefly with the attorney who signed the letter. I think it was Hambill or something.
Gamble.
Okay. And so I'm going to let Ms. Wheeler take it from here as it relates to that. Attorney Wheeler, can you talk to us?
All right. Thank you. Apparently there was a letter received, or the law department received it on Monday, November 26, from the attorney, Assistant Attorney General Nathan Gamble. The letter was written to the court, to Judge Yule, who actually signed the subpoena for Ms. Epke to appear. In the letter, they argue that the court's authority to actually sign the subpoena stating a case out of the First Circuit, which really I don't believe is on point to this. I mean, like I said, you have to look at the background of the case, but like I said, that's their reasoning, that they say that they are not going to, that Ms. Epke does not intend to comply with it. From here, like I said, we're going to even in light of their argument, we have our own arguments, and we're going to, one, you know, request the court to enforce the subpoena. And the other part of it is that in the alternative, then we'll simply, which I believe we're going to come to the same result by them, we'll just simply have somebody from our office sign the subpoena to have them appear. I believe we're going to still end up in the same place, which they're not going to appear because they've made every indication from their letters and emails that they only want to communicate with this body in writing and not in any other means. So I believe we're going to probably end up with them not allowing their employee, which means that Ms. Epke would be refusing to appear here. I mean, she's her decision ultimately, but of course that's going to be based upon the advice that she's receiving from her legal counsel, is not to appear. One of the things that was written to Judge Yule specifically was that the reason why, one of the many reasons among others that they stated in the letter, was that she was not an employee of the city. But we understand that this is something that, pursuant to the charter, is the funding, the flow of funds of the general title of this from the city to the, from the state to the city, is under the auspices of the finance committee. So this is something that's, we're not talking about whether or not she works for them, and many people who do not work for the city of Flint, but the impact of their decisions affect the city. So that's one of the reasons that they stayed in here specifically, is that she doesn't work for the city, but we believe this is an affair of the city, and this is one of the things that would compel her to appear here. So we'll continue to work through that with the court and report back to you.
Mr. President, before you start, I would like to also say that when Ms. Brown, Inez Brown, the clerk, and I were on the phone with the Attorney General's office, Mr. Cole and Amy Epke, we had clear indication that they was never gonna show without the subpoena, but we had requested, and then we issued the subpoena. Now we've issued two subpoenas, and we anticipated circuit court enforcement action. Mr. President.
The letter referenced that the council, and I believe Judge Yule as well, didn't lack the jurisdiction. Talk to me about that, please.
Well, one of the things they talk about is whether or not there is a current and pending case before the circuit court.
Right.
But as the way the charter reads, there would never be a current and pending case before the circuit court, because it's a legislative subpoena that comes from this body.
Right.
Our enforcement and our authority, we'll be exercising this through the court. So, like I said, one of the ways, and this has been done before, is to actually have, I always think it's better the enforcement of a judge versus the enforcement of an attorney. It's just another layer of authority. It's a little higher level than what we can do. But what they're saying, and they've written this directly to the judge to tell the judge that he has no authority. So yeah, that's something that we're working through there. One thing I can say, even in the alternative to their argument, and even if what they say is true, the enforcement still goes through the court. Mm-hmm. So it, like I said, it's going to ultimately end up there anyhow. It's kind of like a long delay in getting where we need to get. So that is one of the things that they do bring up. But when you go back to the actual court rule, or excuse me, the not the court rule, excuse me, the investigative powers under the council, it does talk about specifically enforcement of a matter with regard to a subpoena, mm-hmm. and that would be through that's going to be through the court. So, it, like I said, to enforce a subpoena or order production of evidence or to impose penalties prescribed for failure to obey the subpoena or order, the City Council shall apply to the appropriate court.
Right.
It so, ends up in court.
Yeah. So, Mr. Chair, through you to the city attorney, what if they're talking about the appropriate court, what court would that be?
Could I say this? This could even end up in the Court of Appeals.
Okay.
Judge Ewell could hypothetically rule in our favor, and then they could appeal him to the Court of Appeals. Okay. So this could go on, but it's a necessary process because we need to learn it, and we need to exercise it, not only with city employees or city people, but also with state of Michigan folks. I'm glad to see Mr. Gary Jones here from Congressman Kildee's office kind of watching things, and I appreciate that, and we send the congressman our best, asking to stay on guard, you, him, staff, or others, because y'all got some involvement in the flow of money, and we appreciate it as well as we try to continue things working. Mr. Winfrey, I will acquiesce to the city attorney, but I would say this. One of the arguments that they made is that there was no open case pending in circuit court under a particular court rule, and so the judge had no authority to sign it. I think they cited MCR 2.506. And that might be factual, but also Ms. Wheeler's signature was on there as well, maybe as to form. But we will ask, hopefully, we talked about it, for Ms. Wheeler to issue a third subpoena with her signature in the place of where Judge Ewell's signature was. And we've discussed that. And as of this day, you know, if they issue the subpoena with her name signed where Judge Ewell's was, it takes away the argument that there was no open case pending because they cited MCR 2.506. And when you read 2.506, it talks about circuit court power to issue subpoenas when something is pending before it. Now, enforcement is fixing to be pending because we are getting ready to file a motion to enforce. So all of the little games they play, you can run, but you can't hide, because every law you cite, every little nook and cranny you try to get around as far as not showing up, we're going to look at it. I asked also the legal department, Ms. Wheeler, to look at MCLA 24.273 and 24.273 is another legislative creature. It's an administrative creature for issuing subpoenas. So we don't worry about what they cite. We know that the charter has to be approved by the Attorney General's office. We know the charter and the city of Flint is a creature of state government. They might cite this law, and really the right law on point might be somewhere over the law governing the creation of charters and implementation of charters. So when I seen that the letter went out to all council people, I called Attorney Gamble, because I didn't want a lot of calls going in from council members when we've got legal counsel, and he made it clear that if council people call, he's going to let them know, just like he let me know, that we ought to speak to him through our attorney, which is Attorney Wheeler's office. And I agree with that, Mr. Davis. And that kind of gave me a little ease of mind. So any council person, feel free to talk to Ms. Wheeler as it relates to these proceedings. It's not my proceedings, it's council proceedings. And so I thank us for having a quorum. And I want to send a message to some of those that seem to be repeatedly missing. If you know Mr. President, have you talked to Ms. Fields or Ms. Worthing or any of them that's missing here? And I won't say twice as repeatedly, but find out a time, and we'll do that maybe when they show up, a time that's convenient for them, because I don't like working on the edge of a quorum, but I thank those who are here today that's allowing us to proceed as it relates to a quorum. Mr. Guerra, did I see you?
Yeah, I just wanted to say how disappointed I was in the Attorney General's office when receiving this letter, because it's important to keep in mind that the Attorney General's office is the one that approved the charter that said that we could subpoena individuals, and then it was the Attorney General's office that sent us a letter that said, well, you can't subpoena these individuals. So I was disappointed to see that. Just wanted to state that for the record.
Thank you, Mr. Garrett, particularly when we're in the middle of an emergency and we're dealing with emergency funds. I keep emphasizing this is over $559 million of state and federal money, according to the documents we've received through this hearing from Senator Ananick's office. Are y'all familiar with the documentations and the look? So over $559 million. And I would expect more cooperation with the state when we can read in the media. Zara, I've congratulated her for doing a good job. When we can read that tens of millions of dollars could be held up, and as we vote to make decisions on contracts and receiving this money, we could possibly make decisions short of the information that we need to know. And the MDEQ is acting as a fiduciary. They should have some volunteers that they can send, that's staff members. Amy Epke should be able to come and tell us particularly who is the person or persons making these decisions as it relates to reimbursement. And so these are key questions that we need to know before we release millions of dollars to AECOM and contracts to contractors. We need to know firsthand, not from the newspaper, what is going to qualify for reimbursement. So this is a hearing. It's a timely hearing as it relates to the flow of money from the state of Michigan to the city of Flint. So I'm confident right now in the legal department. Do we need to get outside legal attorney, or how y'all feel with the legal department handling our business right now? Mr. President?
Let's use what we got.
Mr. Guerra? Stick with him, Mr. Davis.
We have the best in the land.
Ms. Galloway. Well, I'm kind of suspicious. I'm watching them because if they don't get these subpoenas right and get us in court, and you will give us a court date on the motion to enforce.
Yeah, if the court accepts it and we're able to do this process, then yes, you will have that. I'll just keep you up to date on procedurally how everything flows through. So once we receive a response, we'll let you know what that response is.
So you anticipate filing a motion to enforce the subpoena within maybe how many days?
Well, we've already prepared it, so like I said, I don't want to give you an exact date, but like I said, we're finalizing things.
Well, you know what I'm looking at, Ms. Wheel. I'm looking at in another 2-3 weeks, stuff will shut down, start winding down for the holidays. And even though I suspect that this hearing will go on, I wanted to make sure I could subpoena and get some folks in court prior to the Snyder administration changing or disappearing. Now, it'll be good if some of them disappear in my mind and the Whitmer administration take over, because maybe her administration will not fight and stuff might move. Then we can cancel the hearing. Maybe. Maybe not. But my point is, I want to move in a timely manner to get these subpoenas out, test some waters, because the people who you and Ms. Galloway know about, Mr. President, is of interest to me. Eric Pocan is starting to weigh in. Ms. Galloway brought his name up as we developed our witness list. So we've got some housekeeping to do maybe on other council discussion to see if we can issue maybe 2-3 more subpoenas. See, I'm this type of guy. Eric Pocaine, who's now weighed in through the media. Rich Baird, who used to show up and keep us abreast on the flow of money. I'm a little risky. I'll test the governor himself, since he the king bee. And I'll ask that we move to issue those subpoenas in other council discussion, because win, lose, or draw, if we go to court on one as a test case, we might as well test some of the others out. Because what happens with the EPCI enforcement and subpoenas, I think will rue for other state folks, whether they elected or appointed. So we're going to learn something here. And I wanted this council, myself and the new members, to go through this process. So in saying that, any more discussion on that discussion item, Ms. Galloway, or wherever you want to proceed?
No, are we moving to the next one then?
Yes.
Okay.
At this time, I would call Mr. Joe Parks. Is it something you wanted before that?
Point of information, yes, it is. Because the agenda item that we're on is rules and procedures. So now, are we ending that, or how does Mr. Parks tie into that agenda item?
No, we had went to rules, past rules and procedures, and we was on the letter dealing with the subpoena, which was the added agenda item. And that was added when we did agenda changes.
Right.
And so then now after that, we was at witnesses.
Okay. Before witnesses, I have a question that I believe is pertinent to purpose of meeting. The city council may conduct an investigative hearing regarding the flow of funds received from the city and the state.
No objections. Proceed.
Okay. So I just have a question about the letter dated November 21st from the Attorney General's office to Attorney William Kim, that's discussing the reimbursement of $2.6 million.
Let's talk about it. I don't know if I'm really familiar with it. It's the city attorney, but proceed.
Okay, and so maybe I should read it.
Yeah, go ahead if you choose.
Okay, so it's addressed to William Kim. City of Flint's violation of the settlement agreement in the Concerned Pastors versus Corey case number. Dear Bill, during the meet and confer held on Friday, November 16, 2018, we discussed the various violations of the settlement agreement identified by the parties. Prior to that call, Counsel for the Natural Resource Defense Council, NRDC, submitted a detailed proposal to resolve the issues arising out of the city's failure to prioritize lead and galvanized steel services lines for excavation and removal. The state parties endorsed NRDC's proposal with some added conditions as set forth in my November 16, 2018 email. As we stated during the call, the state parties believed that prioritization is important to protecting public health in Flint. Although Flint frequently voices concerns about the threat posed by lead and galvanized steel service lines in the city, its failure to prioritize excavations and use hydro excavations to efficiently identify the composition of service lines has actually prolonged the process by allowing thousands of those service lines to remain in use. Any actions that can be taken to more efficiently identify and remove such lines will effectuate the city's stated goal of protecting public health. We believe that the NRDC's proposal will promote that goal and urge the city to ratify it with the state party's amendments. Because of the need to consult with others and presumed absence during Thanksgiving week, you stated that the city would not be able to respond to NRDC's proposal until after November 26, 2018. During the call, you referenced roughly $2,600,000 in open trench excavation costs incurred that DEQ had refused to reimburse Flint. DEQ has allegedly refused to pay those costs based upon state parties' positions that the 10-foot excavations unilaterally mandated by Flint are not covered under the settlement agreement. Although we expressed a willingness to resolve such reimbursement issues in Flint, if Flint would agree to the NRDC's proposal with you expressed that the city was concerned that any payment delay would threaten its liquidity. As a result, you requested that the state parties immediately pay those outstanding amounts. I have spoken with DEQ and determined that, in fact, it has not withheld payment of any funds to Flint because Flint has not yet submitted a final signed reimbursement request to DEQ for any of the Phase 5 cost. Any assertion that the state is currently withholding those funds from Flint is not in accordance with the facts. I acknowledge that DEQ's review of one of Flint's draft Phase 5 reimbursement requests has identified roughly $2.6 million in open trench excavation costs that would not be payable should Flint ever seek a reimbursement. But Flint has never sought a reimbursement, so the state parties have no obligation to pay any costs at this point, which renders the city's demand that DEQ pay those funds while it considers NRDC's proposal moot. We look forward to receiving Flint's comments on the NRDC proposal, which will hopefully assist in resolving all of the outstanding issues. Signed, Richard Cole.
Before you proceed any further, Ms. Galloway, I would like the order that be a part of the record and that document and letter be a part of the record of this hearing, the official hearing, as read and as printed and receive any objections. So ordered. Ms. Galloway.
Was this letter submitted to us through you to the attorney's office or from the administration?
She want to respond. What's okay. The date on that letter?
November 21st.
November 21st, a recent letter, and you know, you heard me say at the beginning, I ain't familiar with it, and I don't know if I am or not, but how did you become familiar with it?
Actually, I received it from Councilwoman Fields.
She sure be busy as a bee. Now, why she ain't told the chairman or
communicated? She actually sent it to everybody.
Oh, well, email it must have came.
Yeah.
And you know how I roll, old school.
Right.
Telephone calls, email. You got it, Mr. Guerra? Probably in your email. See, they're the youngest person, and I know I ain't the oldest, but even the youngest person hadn't read that email.
It was just sent, yes.
So, without any further ado, let me get out the way because it looked like Ms. Wheeler whispered. She ready to respond. Ms. Wheeler, Attorney Wheeler.
I think everybody should know, and I want everybody to know how this has been a magnificent waste of time by the state to have a letter-writing campaign against the city. And that's all this is, because we had a meeting to discuss these things, to resolve these things. And what they did was, on the eve of Thanksgiving, decided to write another letter to us so that we could write another letter to them. So we've been spending a significant time writing letters in the middle of us actually trying to meet and confer to resolve things, not only what they alleged that the city violated, but what we alleged the state violated. And we still contend today that the state is in violation. So we sent a letter in response to their letter. And like I said, you know, we can all pick up our pens and write as much as we want, but what we're going to do is we're going to write based on the fact. And if you'd like, for the record, I'm going to leave it to you. If you want to hear the response that we wrote to the state based on that, then we can certainly read it into the record and provide you with responses to these. So, but like I said, our meeting that we had was a meeting that we would normally have under the concerned pastors. If you have a settlement, if you have a dispute, there's a conflict dispute section that must be exercised prior to going to court. And you have to do that within 14 days of the dispute, which they did and we did. They wanted to change the entire nature of it to say, no, we're just going to go over what you want to. We said to them, you are also in violation, and we're using this because we have to, we are required to have this meet and confer. Whether we resolve anything or not, we have to have that prior to us going back into court. So, like I said, this isn't over by a long shot, but like I said, we gave them in the last call, we gave them until November 27th yesterday to decide whether or not they were going to pay this or they're going to sit here and hold us hostage to a specific form of excavation, which they are. That's not the method by which they decide to reimburse. If we have done everything in accordance and haven't went over the cap, they're supposed to pay us. And for them not to do that is because they're trying to get us to forego doing anything but hydro excavation. And we know that we've had issues with individuals in this community being overlooked, and they would have still had lead in the ground had it not been for using another method other than hydro excavation. And that's what we're concerned about, is the residents. Let me pull this letter up, if you bear with me for just 1 minute, please.
And can I ask you a question? Because there's only a couple of things that I'm interested in knowing about this letter. And that is, who is the NRDC?
I can tell you that. It's National Resource Defense Council. They're the ones who are also in these meetings. And they sent a request for how to do 2019, or what I'm saying is phase six, how to prioritize phase six lead service line replacements.
So they are sent they like a mediator?
No, or they're not like, the mediator. Okay. They're a party to the case.
Okay, I got
and,
you.
Okay. And so they sent the same, like I said, they're sitting here on this little letter writing campaign, okay? And it's to me, it's a lot of, I can't even describe this. I'm so frustrated right now. But they send these letters, and they know full well from being in the meeting that we had just received it, just like they just received the information from the NRDC, that we have to also have time to review it and go over it to see how we can actually make things happen. We can't just get a letter and then say, yeah, we're going to just do everything that you say. We have to calculate everything that's in that, and which we have done since we've come back from the holiday.
Right.
So, like I said, while we're all trying to enjoy our families, we're sitting around writing letters so that these can become a subject for the media, except doing things through the court where we're supposed to have these disputes.
And then my last question, and then you can go into the letter, is what they're stating factual that the $2.6 million invoice had not, in fact, been submitted.
I think that, let me just say this, because I don't want to misspeak for our CFO. But what I understand is this, is that there's some type of pre-approval type of thing that they have worked out through the state where they submit them in advance. So they're splitting hairs now. They're sitting here and they are trying to use every loophole they can to get out of saying what their compliance is. So that's something completely different. But I can read you the actual letter that is responsive to this if you want that.
Okay, and I want to do a referral. I'd like to make a referral to Mr. Newsom for a copy of that submitted final $2.6 million invoice.
Janelle, Ms. Brown, did y'all get that request? I would like that request expedited to Mr. Newsom and the response back to Ms. Galloway and the rest of the council members, and a copy for the clerk's office. I will see if he will expedite that request. If there's no objections, I would so order. The media keep coming up, and you know, I hope there's no objections, but I've seen a hand go up. I do use the media sometime to get information. We all do. So I want to see what that chime in hand wants to say. Ms. Okay, hold on. She wants to read a letter in response. Ms. Wheeler, you have the floor.
All right. The letter says, this is the letter in response to Attorney Kuhl's letter that he sent on November 21st. It says, Dear Richard, this letter is in response to your letter dated November 21st, as well as in response to statements made in your November 14th letter and at our November 16th meet and confer.
Ms. Wheeler, before you get too far down the road, this letter is from who to who?
This letter is from Assistant Attorney General Richard Kuhl, who has been a part of the Concerned Pastors Settlement litigation. He's been there for the DEQ and the state of Michigan.
He was in that conference call with us, and it's from him to who?
This is to Bill Kim, who's one of the attorneys who handles the settlement
agreement. And
the
letter you referred to, Ms. Galloway, was from?
That one was from the Attorney General to Attorney Kim, so this one must be Attorney Kim to.
Right, this is a response to that, because these are.
This is from Kim to, okay.
There's a reason these letters are written the way they are.
Okay, but I just want to, yeah.
Yeah.
And so it had been said a little differently. Proceed.
Right.
Could you start over?
Yes.
And proceed?
Dear Richard, this letter is in response to your letter dated November 21st, as well as in response to statements made in your November 14th letter. Oops. Your November 14th letter and at our November 16th meet and confer, as has been the practice since at least 2016. The city has submitted a service line replacement invoices to the MDEQ for pre-approval. On November 7th, MDEQ project manager Eric Pocan emailed the city regarding the city's September 25th submission of those invoices for MDEQ's review and stated unequivocally that the exploration charges will be withheld on this request. To require that the city request reimbursement for invoices that the city has already declared it will deny, that the state has already declared it will deny, elevates from form over substance and is not required under the settlement agreement. Instead, paragraph 23B of the settlement agreement clearly states that the Michigan Department of Environmental Quality shall not unreasonably withhold reimbursements or payments. Instead, it provides only that the reimbursements may not exceed $5,000 per address. Nothing in that paragraph or in any other paragraph of the settlement agreement allows the MDEQ to deny a reimbursement based on the cost of excavation. The city demands that the state fulfill its obligation under the settlement agreement and reimburse the city for its 2018 service line replacement activities, including the open cut excavations that were the city's approved method of excavation in 2018. In 2018, the use of open cut excavation identified 9 households with spliced service lines that would have been misidentified as copper using hydrovac excavation. To the city, that represents 9 families who would have been unnecessarily exposed to lead had the city not switched to open cut excavation. It is clear that the city believes that relying on a method that would have exposed 9 households in the city of Flint to lead is acceptable. That's to the state. Mayor Weaver strongly disagrees. The city, pursuant to paragraph 2.1 of the settlement agreement, has authority to select the method of excavation used, and nothing gives the state any right to override the decision of the city on appropriate excavation methods. Based on our discussion to date, all parties to the Concerned Pastor Settlement Agreement appear to agree that appropriate prioritization of service line replacement in 2019 is important to protecting the public health of Flint residents. To that end, we appreciate and are currently reviewing the NRDC's proposal. However, NRDC's proposal was received on November 16th after your November 1st and November 14th letters and my November 5th letter. The city thus considers NRDC proposal to be a separate issue from the state's clearly expressed intention to deny reimbursement for already completed work. While we expect to complete our review of the NRDC's proposal and are willing to discuss these matters further later this week, the city cannot agree to formally tie any agreement on appropriate prioritization of service line replacement activity in 2019 to reimbursement of expenses that have already been incurred in 2019 to the reimbursement of expenses that have been incurred in 2018. As you may be aware, the city submitted its formal reimbursement request on Wednesday, November 21st. This morning, Mr. Pocan notified the city that the request should be to the penny and not rounded, and that the only requests that should be rounded are for wind funds. This is a new requirement that the state has not previously imposed on the city's reimbursement request, and about which the city was not notified until Mr. Pocan's email. By the time you receive this letter, the city will have either submitted or intends to submit an amended reimbursement request and expects that the city will promptly process and reimburse the city and expects that the state will promptly process and reimburse the city for costs that it has incurred to date. If the city truly is interested in ensuring that the 2019 service line replacement efforts are conducted in an efficient and effective manner, MDEQ should be directed to approve reimbursements of excavations conducted in 2018 unless those reimbursements are otherwise objectionable under the settlement agreement. Indeed, MDEQ has previously determined that a number of reimbursement requests were ineligible for various reasons, and the city has accepted those determinations where appropriate. Here, they clearly are not, and the state's expressed intention to deny reimbursement violates the terms of the Concerned Pastor Settlement Agreement.
And that's signed by who?
That's signed by William Kim.
And that's dated what?
November 26th, which would have been Monday
holiday. I would ask that November 26th letter from Attorney Kim be admitted in the records of this investigative hearing as read, and I would ask that copies be given to all council members with no objections. Mm-hmm. So
sure
ordered.
Copies to us.
Ms. Wheeler, between you and Janelle, maybe y'all can get copies of that letter to each other and get it distributed to council members, as well as the letter that Ms. Galloway read into the record. If that can happen, Chairman is satisfied. I'm eager to respond. Ms. Galloway, you opened up this agenda dialogue that wasn't on there, but with no objections, proceed.
I just wanted to make sure that I heard something that Attorney Wheeler read. It sounded as though I heard the letter say that the reimbursement from the city was submitted on the same day that the letter and or email was sent. And so it could be that there was just a crossing of information.
You see me laying back, and y'all see each other. When y'all get to talking, I'm laying back.
Well, that's talking about one, but you probably need to read the letters before, because there are other and reimbursements requests that have been submitted before that date. So let me not misspeak. I don't have the letters in front of me.
Yeah.
But the other letters that are referenced in there, they're discussing these things, because, like I said, before we go and move to court, we have certain obligations that we have to do to try to resolve these things. And we have tried to do that through dialogue and through previous letters prior to the one they decided to send on the 21st after our Friday meeting before the holiday on the 16th. So they sent one the 21st, which was, you know, a couple days before the holiday. So, like I said, I had believed that we had genuinely met with the state and had given them, as we discussed, until yesterday to see if they were going to, as they said, they were going to speak with the governor and the powers to be to see if they were going to pay these reimbursements. And then we get a letter. So, like I said, it's a little bit disingenuous that we would have an actual sit-down meeting with them to try to resolve it, and then this is what we end up with.
I just want to say, for the record, I know that there's some back and forth. What I want to do, my goal, is to affirm or not the $2.6 million. And the reason why I say that, and I say that to my colleagues, is because sometimes you have to pick one piece at a time. And since that's what you reference in this letter, I just want to be able to identify that for right now. The rest of it is much bigger in scope. I understand that. I believe it'll be answered by Mr. Newsom.
It's about 557 million dollars bigger.
Well,
so no, I subtracted the 2.6 from the 59.
But it's important to know that document that was sent to us had everything to do with every single dollar that came into the city and wasn't necessarily related to the water crisis. And that's one of the misconceptions. And that's very, very, very important.
But it's not a misconception for me, but it's documented in Ananick's breakdown.
Yeah, we talked
and so
about
we'll
that.
Be talking about it. Zara, I apologize. Can you let us hear what you want to chime in? Because the media is in the middle. Come on, let us. There's Zara from M Live. This is who we've been reading and talking.
I just want to clear up.
Put the mic down where we can hear. Is that button pushed?
Is it good now?
And state your name for the record.
Move it closer.
Zara.
We want to see if that mic works. Is that red more up or more down? It should be up.
All right, is this good?
Okay, that's...
All right, I think it's good, Janelle. Yeah, is that good?
Yeah.
All right, cool.
Talking to it.
Cool. So, I just wanted to clear up what the NRDC's role in this, because you had mentioned that, and it's a bit confusing with all these different parties involved and everything. So the NRDC is a plaintiff in the concerned pastor's settlement, and so they kind of provided some attorneys when that case was going on, when the settlement was agreed on. And I believe that they have been filing a series of motions throughout the summer trying to enforce some of the settlement's agreements. So I'm assuming, I know that the most recent proposal is in regard to their most recent motion. I believe that was filed in October 1st, I wanna say. So that's kind of the role that they're playing in all of this. That's all I have to say.
Are you talking about the one asking for them to use the predictive modeling?
Yeah, I think the original motion that they had filed was in regard to the 18,000, that number, and how it had how you guys came up with that number. And then I believe that that motion then changed after they talked to those two researchers from U of M. I believe they did a statistical analysis, and then they withdrew the motion to enforce two.
Yeah, they withdrew it. It's no longer pending.
Yeah,
it's withdrawn.
Yeah, but they raised a different issue up.
In court, you have to file something if you're going to raise it in court. Or
yeah, they, that was
it's,
the,
it's
that's,
withdrawn.
That's the October 1st motion, I believe. They withdrew the two concerns that they had and then brought up a different concern about what they wanted to enforce within the settlement.
You're not talking about in court, though, is what I'm saying. You're talking about something separate.
I believe that they filed that to a U.S. District Court.
Okay, so that's the issue.
That's where I got the information from.
Why don't you get that to us? This
We did have that documentation, those court things. I read it in my email, so... we can pull it up. Those are the documents you're referring to, right?
Yeah, and I'm just bringing that up because I know that sometimes we have questions about where like information comes from, especially with reporting in the news, and all of that information is coming from records that were filed to the court. So yeah,
and
it's
I'm
public
sure,
record, and it's totally fine.
And yeah. I'm sure you're going to keep hearing the news, and every time we hear the news, I appreciate you chiming in with us, because what we're trying to do is going to be for the betterment of the citizens of the city of Flint as a whole. And we're going to be that detail. So that's what we're working for. That's who we're working for. And I believe that's our goal. Mr. Guerra.
You just said you read that in your email. I thought you don't read your email.
I do read it sometime. I got a personal email, Eric Mays, all small case letters, forthecity@gmail.com. The number for Eric Mays, small case letters, forthecity@gmail.com. Then I got my city email, which Janelle kind of been helping me with for 4 or 5 years. And when something comes through the city, we collaborate. So that's a misnomer. I do read emails, but not as regularly as some of the millennials. Let me say this. My position is this. I'm an advocate of hydrovacking. As the chairman of this committee, I'm only one vote, and I'm only one person in the city, but I'm an advocate of hydrovacking and the use thereof. I don't agree with the decision that the city has made, and the concerned pastor's agreement is the city. It's not just the executive branch, it's the city. The city is the legislative branch, the executive branch. It includes the city attorney's office. So when you look at these consent agreements and the concerned pastor's consent agreement, which the council, we went in executive session. Some of y'all remember Ms. Galloway, we was looking at that. Remember, we was told whether it would have financial implications as we, you know, so just I'm bringing you up to speed. So we are part of the consent agreement. And when they say the city, we are a part of the city. So if one part of the city or some people in the city is opposed to hydrovac and another person in the city, in this case me, is an advocate of hydrovac, we'll maybe get to a point after we finish our investigation as to how we feel as a council body as it relates to hydrovac. We haven't took that formal vote or asked to pass a resolution or nothing of that nature, but all of this is going to be relevant. But I can speak on where I'm at with hydrovac, and I'm like, it's just a tool, like a shovel, a backhoe, excavator, hydrovac, it can be in there, just like pliers and screwdrivers and so forth and so on. I'm not convinced, Ms. Galloway, that if you use shovels, hydrovac, backhoes, excavation, cutting materials, when I say cut, because you have to cut some of the cement and sidewalk in some cases in the street, I'm not sure you're going to still be at $300 a hole. The price could fall somewhere between that $300 and $1,700. And so this whole argument between the state and the city about the state saying it would be $300 and you'd save this many, I'm not buying into that yet, because it could be somewhere in between. Mr. Parks has testified that it's just a tool. They still might have to do backhoe and excavation, and that might not be just a $300 cost. So we'll get to the bottom of it, and as part of the city and the consent agreement, maybe we'll be the ones to help the city reach a compromise and keep this thing moving forward. And so those are my goals, and I talk regularly with the administration. I've given the administration a seat at the table right there, whether it's the city administrator, the mayor, Mr. Newsom, all during these hearings. And I've given the city attorney, I articulated yesterday, if the state come and there's some questions that she won't ask, anybody can feel free to ask questions and bring witnesses and communicate. This is an open hearing and is run by the council, not by the chairperson. In saying that, Ms. Galloway, I would recommend in the future, when you want to introduce a letter, you do it during the agenda changes or amendments, but without objection. I think that was relevant, and I think it was relevant under the agenda item purpose. And are you finished, or is it something else, Ms. Galloway? And I hope you don't let my business and humor demeanor. This is a day I'm not out to offend nobody. Ms. Galloway had me in tears, crying and praying on the phone. Mr. Guerra, don't take her phone calls no more, because she be praying and stuff, you know. Praying, Maurice, that I can be good and better, and I'm all in tears, crying, then I'm praying. So, you know, it's been some little praying going on, so don't let nobody get pissed today. We done prayed. Okay, under the circumstances, if we can, let's proceed with Mr. Parks from Goyette. Hopefully I won't get to crying.
Since he's already
been before, he doesn't have to be. Yeah. Ms. Brown, would you state that for the record?
I'll let you state it.
She says, since he's been sworn and we ask that he continue as a witness, we don't have to swear him again, and that's true. So you understand you've been sworn in this proceeding, Mr. Parks.
I do.
And can you state who you with? Would she like to join you?
I think it would be appropriate today to have her on.
Sure. Would you swear her in, Ms. Brown? Y'all want to wait for Joe Fike before you swear in? No, I'm just kidding. Proceed.
Okay. I swear to tell the truth. The whole truth?
Yes,
and nothing but the truth.
Yes,
and could you then state your name for the record? Okay, I want to see if we can get one of them other microphones down there from one of these empty seats, however we move it around.
Is that better?
Yeah, I think it's more in the up position. You might have to go with that one that Mr. Davis got or something and move it around. Thank you, Janelle. Janelle, what's your last name? What is it? Thank you, Mrs. Jensen. All right, look, last time Mr. Parks was here, a lot of the colleagues in this row as chair asked questions or whatever, and I said I didn't get a chance to, and so I asked him to come back because I've got some specific questions that I think is relevant to this hearing. If I may proceed, Mr. Parks, when you was here last time, one of the things that I'm concerned about is this invoice. You've referred to an invoice that has not been paid. Can you tell me about that? Because I've got some follow-up questions.
Yeah. So the very beginning of the project, during our first pay application, we invoiced for, I don't know how many total addresses, but of those addresses, there were 15 that were rejected. And they rejected our entire invoice as a result of it. Those 15 addresses were done on the first day of the project, and I believe that was June 6th. The reason the AECOM claimed that those addresses were rejected is because as part of the work that we did on those 15 addresses, we utilized a hydrovac truck as part of our means of excavation.
What was the cost of those invoices?
It totaled roughly $25,000 for those 15 addresses.
And have they been paid yet?
They have not.
Is there any more outstanding invoices that you guys know of?
We have outstanding invoices, but they have not been rejected.
Okay, so they have not been rejected. So the only rejection invoices, would it be fair to say, is the $25,000?
That's correct.
And that one is caught up in hydrovacking. Let me ask you this question. As it relates to your restoration project or contract, who is your point of contact person for restoration issues?
That would be me, sir.
Can you give us a contact number, name and contact number?
For the restoration side?
Yeah.
Yep, you can contact our office at 810-743-6883. And if they press number one, they'll bring it right to our restoration service line. 743-6883, and then press number one.
6883.
Yep.
Have the plants closed and is restoration shut down yet for this season? If not, when?
Restorations have been ongoing up until this week. We're going to work on any soft surfaces that we can, but the plants are closed down and hard surfaces are getting wrapped up this week.
So this...
So the city also has advised us that as of December 15th, they would not like us out working anymore on restorations.
Okay. And so that way I can inform residents that stuff that's not pretty much done now will carry over to next
season.
Yeah, we
will pick up
season.
First thing in the spring.
And it'll be under the same contract?
Correct.
That's that $11 million contract?
That is correct.
That's what we're being told by the city right now.
Yes.
Yep. Okay, I'm not in objection to that. But if that contract had a date certain and that type of thing, I'm trying to get the administration and others to come to us for these approvals and extensions prior to rather than after the fact. Do you know whether it had date certain or time?
Councilman Mays, yeah, there is a substantial completion date and a final completion date written into the contract. We're just being told right now that it's going to be extended into next spring so that work can continue, similar to how phase four restorations continued into 2018.
Yeah, and I'm familiar with that.
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll be talking about it legally as it relates to notices to proceed and all of that, and we do kind of work pretty good with the administration as a city, so I hear what's being said, and it sounds interesting and good to me. So about how much of that $11 million contract do you know whether or not you was able to get done in this season? Any roundabout figures?
Around about $3
million. About $3 million in restoration?
Correct.
And your contract for service line replacement was about how much?
So the contract is roughly $5.6 million.
And about how much of that did you get done in this season so far, do you know? And when will that date come to an end?
So our last invoicing period is through the 24th, well, week ending 11/24. So the last day of work was Tuesday before Thanksgiving, so last Tuesday. And that amount is?
Through 11/24, we will be billing estimated around $4
million. Around $4
million. Yep.
Out of the five, so because there's been some talk about leftover money as it relates to contracts. Now, do you relate any of that to the area that you were working in as far as hit rates?
Yeah, so the address.
Do the council know what I mean by hit rates? Okay, and the council, even though I'm asking questions, you can chime in at any time. I don't mind. Proceed.
So, council members, Councilman Mays, I'm assuming you're speaking to the ratio of copper services found.
Yeah, what zones were you in and what part of town?
So, zones 9 and 10, essentially between Center Road and Dort Highway, past Dort Highway to
go
the west.
Go slow, Center Road and Dort Highway.
And even past west of Dort Highway in certain areas. Towards Mott College area. From all the way down past Lippincott, all the way down to Atherton in
Sound
some places.
Like they was in your area somewhat,
we
Ms. Galloway, and the Ninth Ward.
And then up into past Davison Road to the north.
About how many crews did you have?
We've had roughly 4 crews on the project for the duration of the job.
And Goyette subcontracted that service line replacement work out?
We self-perform a portion of the work. And
about what percentage?
About 50% of the work.
So 50% self-performed and 50% subcontracted out. I know I've had some talk about do we want to do an ordinance with 75%, but I think you're in line because there's nothing there. Proceed. 50% subcontracts, 50% self-performed. Now, what happened when the scope of the work change in the contract as it relates to exploratory excavation?
The scope of the work in terms of, are you speaking in terms of the hydrovac program being banned?
And I'm referring to the scope of any changes of work as it relates to you as a contractor. If this is,
yes, sir.
If this season is over and the scope of work changed, are you satisfied that you've been compensated properly at this time based upon what I've heard you say so far?
No.
So how much difference would you think that you...
Based on the changes that we've documented and have kept records on and submitted to the city and AECOM, we have, as of the same time period through 11/24, we have a running total of extra costs at $706,000.
$706,000. So they haven't been denied, but that's just what's been submitted. Is it not timely based upon your practice of getting a turnaround?
I don't believe it's timely. No, we these costs were documented in June. These changes were documented in June by us. The first change of banning our use of hydrovac equipment for any reason, that was banned on the first day of the project, which was June 6th.
This $700,000 cost kind of reflects some of the changes y'all made based upon the scope that might or might not have changed. Do you have any documentation there? I'm seeing you looking at something. Do you have anything that we can copy or that you want to submit, or is that just for you?
I'm happy to submit all. You can have everything here after I'm going to need something to look at through the rest of the hearing here today, but I'm happy to submit this to you at the end when we're done.
Okay. Anybody got anything? Continue to proceed. If it's something you or her need us to know as you talk, I might jump back in. Council people might jump in, talk about what you want us to know.
So at the point that we're at today is we've submitted all of this whole stack of documentation we have right here to keep track of two really simple issues.
This is on the service line replacement.
This is the service line project.
What is these costs for?
These costs, the first of two items is the ban of the hydrovac truck on the service line replacement contract. Has nothing to do with Martha Brown's contract. Our use of the hydrovac truck is entirely different than hers. We've talked about it in previous sessions here.
So are you saying that you spent $700,000 on just that because you changed, or it's a combination? That's just one part
of it. That's the first.
What do that itemize out to be? Do you
roughly $360,000?
Okay. Ms. Galloway, go ahead. Just jump in there, Ms. Tagira, Ms. Galloway, if it's something you want. Go ahead.
Originally, the two of you spoke to me in the summertime, raising your concerns almost immediately after they happened.
Yes.
Of which I brought it before the council in a committee meeting. And I believe that Mr. Gilchrist came to one of the meetings. But my question to you is, since that meeting and that time where I actually issued copies of what you had given me at the time, have you received a response from the administration and or AECOM based on your proposal that shared that because they had changed your ability to use the very equipment that was included in your bid, this is what those changes would cost our company, and therefore we need to renegotiate and or change, since, according to you all, since the city decided to make a change to the contract, mm-hmm. you also wanted to submit the difference. Have you since then received a response to your correspondence to them saying, this is the difference, this is what we need to see happen?
No, we have not received any official response from the city or from AECOM.
When you say official, mm-hmm. because it seems like even though you received a letter, there was a verbal sure. from someone. And so when you say official, does that mean we've heard something but nothing has been official?
So Mr. Gilchrist has told us we're not going to pay you. But at that time, there wasn't even an understanding of these issues. He was lumping us in with the hydrovac contractor Martha Brown's issues. These are two totally separate issues, and there wasn't a good understanding of what we're even bringing to the table. So that was just in a meeting with Mr. Gilchrist. Since that time, we have submitted a lot more documentation for clarity. And that was all submitted. We were told to submit that through AECOM so that they could provide their opinion on these issues. So that was roughly in July.
I have one more question.
And so we still have not received AECOM's opinion on whether or not our claims are legitimate legitimate changes to the documents that they wrote that we bid to. Basically what we need AECOM to say to us is what I believe is their responsibility is to say, okay, here this is what you're claiming. You're claiming that the vac truck, you're allowed to use the vac truck as in the bid documents that you guys bid to. You guys bid to a set of documents. In those documents allow the vac truck. We agree that those documents allow the vac truck, use of the vac truck. Or they could say, no, right here in these documents, you guys can't use the vac truck because of this reason. So we've submitted these claims stating that there's nothing in those stating that we can't use the vac truck, and we bid this project with the idea that we would have heavy utilization of the vac truck for the service line replacement project.
So you're simply saying that you don't have a problem with not using it. You just want that to be identified in the bidding process in those contractual documents support what they're trying to enforce upon you.
At this point, what we bid, we already bid to them. So, and during that, what we bid was to use them.
Right.
So if they're going to tell us that we can't use the vac truck, which is what they did.
And you didn't use them.
And we have not used them.
And so now you're billing.
Yeah, and since day one, we've said, okay, we're not going to use the vac truck until you let us, but it costs us this much more money. You need to pay us for it.
So have you met with anybody outside of Mr. Gilchrist?
We've tried to schedule meetings, have communication.
Have you met with anybody outside of Mr. Gilchrist?
AECOM.
But so you have sat down with them on this issue?
Oh, they won't reply to us on this. I spoke with Ed Tharp today over email. He's... we've been made aware that Darby Nydig has resigned from AECOM, the project manager for AECOM, who is in the middle of providing a reply to the city about this issue.
Which one is Darby?
Darby.
Ed, was Darby the
he
lady?
Was, no, oh. Darby was here Ed, the other day. So,
Ed yeah. made us aware that Ed made us aware that Darby has provided an opinion, or AECOM has provided an opinion with the city, and discussions are being had between AECOM and the city. We have not, nobody has told us what that opinion is on whether these, if AECOM believes that these changes are legitimate or not. That's what we need to know so we can move on to the next step.
Mr. President.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Parks.
Yes, sir.
I need a little bit more clarity on the $360,000 yep. specifically for
sure.
What was it for?
The $360,000 is for
work that we've done on 1,680 addresses. So on those 1,680 addresses, we have not had use of the hydrovac equipment.
Okay.
And in our bid, we bid unit prices. So for example, we bid to do an exploratory excavation, which is essentially you dig at a home,
right,
you find that it's copper to copper, and then you fill the hole back in. To do that work, our proposal was $1,682. As part of that
$1,682 per
hole.
Address.
Per exploratory excavation.
Okay, 1,600.
1,682.
That was the bid.
That was our bid to
that
do.
That you won.
That we won. That was, yep, that was approved. The city accepted that bid, and we were given a purchase order as we were given a contract to do work based on that $1,682.
And we approved the contract.
Yep, that's correct. And that came through council.
Mr. President, I'm sorry.
And part of that $1,682 includes our use of the vac truck. We built that number. $1,682 was built. We came to that number by our estimated plugging in all these different things. Digging with a backhoe, digging with shovels, digging with a hydrovac truck, having men on the job to utilize all that equipment. All those things go into that $1,682. So when the city told us that you can no longer use that hydrovac truck, well, then we had to go back to the table and say, okay, what is it going to cost us now that we cannot use the vac truck? That we plugged all that in and that number went up. So now that we have a contract for $1,682 per address that we're doing an exploratory dig at, well, we're in trouble now.
And do you know what the number went up to?
I do. So for an exploratory dig, let me find my number here.
I see Mr. Guerra, but Mr. President got the floor. You wouldn't know it. I keep asking questions.
So for an exploratory dig, it went up to $190 more. So you'd add $190 to that $1,682. And that's for not having the vac truck.
Mm-hmm. Mr. President, between you and Mr. Gary, y'all both got something on that.
Go ahead.
So for every exploratory dig that we've done since then, we have been documenting $190 additional cost for that, which hasn't been approved, so we haven't been able to invoice it yet. So that is part of that $360,000. The other part, for if we were to dig that hole and we find that we have to replace a line, so that would be just a service line replacement. It doesn't matter if it's a full or a partial, or it doesn't matter what line size. It's just if we have to replace anything, that number is $340. I'm sorry, that number is $334. So that would be on top of that. So
that bid unit.
Yep. So we had our bid units for replacements. There's too many of them. I could read through all of them right now, but they depend. And any one of them is affected by $334 additional on top of that bid unit. So if you take those $334 for replacements and the additional $190 for exploratories, all of those add up to $360,000 based on the work that we've done. That's how much extra work that we have accumulated, extra cost that we've accumulated as a result of not being able to use our hydrovac equipment.
Thank you, Mr. Parks.
You're welcome, Mr. President.
Yeah, I just wanted to clarify. I think that my understanding, the reason we stopped using the hydro evacuation was because of when we were doing the spot checking, we were missing that, but you're not using it in that aspect, which I think is important to keep in mind for people who are listening to this. You're using it as a tool simply just to dig around and not use a shovel or other equipment.
That's correct.
But you're still looking at the full pipe. You're not.
That's
just
correct.
So I, to my understanding, I don't understand why you would not be allowed to use hydro evacuation in that capacity. I'm just saying I agree with you. That's what I just wanted to say.
Well, thank you. And I think that is also important. And that was what was we believe, and I to this day I believe that the mayor's office made any decision that they have made based on the hydrovac equipment and their ban on the hydrovac equipment, I think they made it for good reasons. And it was the reasons were to protect the citizens of the city. And I just think that they had limited information on how the work is done. And they had a limited understanding at the time that these decisions were made. And so because of that, they lumped the hydrovac equipment all into one big bowl, and they took that whole bowl away from everybody. So there's no hydrovac equipment is allowed for anybody. When really the health and safety issues that they were speaking to were
revolved around Martha Brown's contract.
They really only were an issue for the hydrovac investigation contract.
I agree and I understand where that's coming from. I also wanted to know, you mentioned the $360,000 so far that you, I was wondering where the rest of that, you said it was $706,000 in total?
Sure.
So where the rest of the money is coming from?
So everything we spoke about so far is the hydrovac issue. There's a second issue, and it's the size of the exploratory digs were increased post-bid. So at the time of the bid, there was no specification on how large these excavations had to be or how much service line material had to be exposed. We've bid previous phases of this project. We've done a lot of work. We did over 3,000 lines going into this year before phase five even started. And so we had a really good idea of the work that needed to be done and what accepted practices are. And so since there was no specification on the size of these excavations, we could only go based on what we knew. So what we knew was that roughly 2 to 3 feet of service line had to be exposed so that there would be some kind of confidence that we were catching all the copper. Also, additionally, the exploratory specification stated that we would only be doing these exploratory digs if the hydrovac contractor, Martha Brown, could not do their work on a specific address. And so we had to go basically look at their specification for their contract, and they only have to expose 18 inches of line on each side of the box. On each side of the curb valve. Okay, so we took those two, that piece of information, what Martha Brown was supposed to do, and then we also used our past experience, and that's what we used to bid the job. Well, after the bid, after it was accepted, we were given a contract. AECOM issued a notice on June 22nd, I believe it was 21st or 22nd, and they stated that these excavations now had to be larger than the approved practice. They now had to expose 4 to 5 feet on each side of the box, so that equals 8 to 10 feet rather than 2 to 3. And so that equals over, we're now removing over 100% more material. We have to excavate more than 100% more material out of the ground. So that increases our cost dramatically, because not only is it the time on the equipment, but we got laborers out there. So we're going to effectively do less work in the same amount of time. So we have the second issue, I basically title larger excavations. We have to provide a larger excavation to the city now than what we bid.
Pause right there, if you will, Mr. Parks.
Yes, sir.
Remember, I keep showing y'all these connections. That's what they were using to connect lead and copper. If it was a break primarily on the public side, between the shutoff valve and the water main, that's where mainly the splices was, the band-aids. Yeah. They would fix them, splice them, put them together, and if you dug 18 feet out, you might look like copper, but then when you get to the splice 4 or 5 feet out, the rest would be lead or galvanized. So those out of 6 or 7 that they say they kept missing, and some people say it was because of the hydrovac, I say it was because of the scope of the contract. Martha Brown's contract could originally say go 5 feet on each side or 18 inches. So I don't blame the hydrovac. I blame the scope of the contract on what was given for them to, bid. Proceed, Mr. Parks.
Yeah, and that's a good point. And the mayor, I think, made a good decision when she stated that she needs these excavations to be larger. And I want to repeat that these decisions she's making, even though they're costing us more money, I do believe that they're good decisions.
And I agree with that. And I believe as a result of that, as we talk about the flow of money and reimbursements, we will all be working to get people paid and then move forward with all of the knowledge in phase six.
Right.
Proceed.
And we're absolutely huge supporters of anything that's going to do to make this program better. But even when you make a decision for the betterment of the program, there still may be costs associated with it. And so if these ideas of making these excavations larger would have been addressed before all of the contractors bid the program, then our numbers would have been what they were. We would have bid 4 to 5 feet. That's not what we bid because that's not what was in there. And so that was a change. And we're due fair payment for that change. And we've had no response from AECOM or from the city on that either. And that change, I think I stated a minute ago, but that change is worth roughly $346,000 for roughly 1,300 addresses have been impacted as a result of that change. And though we agree with the change, we still are due fair payment for the work that we're doing.
Can I make a referral to AECOM to respond to Goyette Mechanical? Can I make a referral to AECOM to respond to that?
Yeah. I would order that AECOM respond to the Goyette invoices, hopefully in the next 3 to 10 days, and then give us a copy of the response as requested and referred by Mr. Garrow, and I would order that without objections unless there's any amendments or addition to the referral.
Can I clarify?
Hold on, Mr. Parks. Okay, go ahead.
We have an invoice for any, I know you'd said invoices. I just want to make sure that when you, just to be proper, that we haven't invoiced for any of this yet. All we've done is submitted costs.
Invoice would not be the proper word.
Our proposals. Cost proposals.
I would amend that referral from Mr. Garrett to identify them as cost proposals versus invoices. Any other clarifications or additions? If not, I would order that without objections. And I want the turnaround time to be specific, if I may, 3 to 10 days? Okay. Ms. Galloway.
Mr. Parks, I have a question for you. So there might be some that say, or question, just kind of being devil's advocate, if that's the right word, that might say none of the other contractors,
yes, ma'am,
are saying anything about this.
Yes, ma'am.
And so I want you, in your best summation of that, to be able to share with this community why you are, even though maybe they might not be.
So we've been in business since 1928. I can't speak for the other contractors, but we have a really, really good handle on our costs. We've done so many jobs. We do so much work every year. We have our costs and our budgets nailed down to the penny. And so we know what things cost, what costs us. I can't speak to any of the other contractors. I know some of the other contractors have higher costs than us on certain bid items. For example, the exploratory unit. Ours is at $1,682. Some of them are over $1,900. They may have bid that unit with the plan that they weren't going to use a vac truck at all. So that may not even be part of the equation for them. I can't speak to any other reasons on why other contractors wouldn't be submitting costs on this. I know last year, us and one other contractor did use hydrovac equipment. During phase four, we used hydrovac equipment on virtually every single house that we worked on.
Who was the other contractor?
WT Stevens, and their subcontractors. And they did so with a lot of success, similar to us. I can't speak for any of the other contractors. I haven't spoken with any of them on it. I do know that we have a system, that the way we bid the job, that is extremely effective. And we've had to abandon that system because of the decisions that were made by the city, and we're having to use a different system that is also effective. I do want to say that the system that we're using right now is, we get a ton of productivity even without the vac truck. The only problem with that is we've had to put more people on the job, so it's costing us more money, tons more man hours we're putting into this. But I just do want you to know that the work is going really well. We're getting a lot done. We're getting a lot accomplished, even without the tool. We wish we had it because our costs would be lower. We'd probably have a little bit more work done. Our productivity would be higher. Our efficiency would be higher. But with that said, we're still achieving a lot without it.
I appreciate that answer. And the reason why I wanted to ask that question on the record is because a couple of things stick out to me. Hearing what you said and how your company makes it a priority to bid based on efficiency, which would have brought you coming into a municipality at a lower bid than some of the other contractors when you look at apples to apples,
sure.
Right? And so that's very important to say, you know what, we wanted to make sure that in an effort to save the city money, that we also too could still do what we needed to do and still provide profitability for our company as well. But the other thing is, I think that I don't care who you are, any municipality, whether you are in private or in the, what do they call, corporate America. I believe that people should be paid based on contracts. And so one of the things that's been expressed is this is all new to all of us. There isn't really a model out there, if you will. But if decisions are being made post-bid, and we're expecting the state to pay money for these things, then all of those things should be evaluated. And I just want to say to you, I'm really sorry.
I thought you was asking a question. Do you want to ask him, do he feel whether
no,
or not
No, I
sorry?
Just want to apologize to you on behalf of the city, because you did, Kent, thank you. You did express your concern. We did share that. And so the fact that it's been all of these months, 5 months at least, and you still haven't received a response is disappointing. But also, I think that it's important to not look at a company and think that just because a company may be profitable or they may be longstanding, they deserve to be paid what they bring to a community. And so I just want everything to be fair and right for all contractors. And so that's the thing that bothers me the most, is that so many decisions are being made after the contract. And if, in fact, Joe, I hear you saying, if, in fact, we misidentify what we thought we could do where the bid was concerned, and you bring that to our attention, is it safe to say that in hearing you, you're saying, hey, if we bid this, and you guys accepted it, but there was something in the contract that actually said, no, this can't work, we're fine with that. Is that a safe estimate?
I am fine with that, because I know that I have strong ground to stand on.
Okay. Mr. Parks, as it relates to the restoration contract, is it common that most contracts might have like a year or 2 year warranty, but in these contract cases on restoration, we got like 60 or 90 day?
In terms of
the work, I'm concerned as we move into phase six, what is the, I'm gonna call it warranty for lack of better word, but after 90 days, who do we call if it's a problem?
So are you referring to the temporary restorations after the service lines, or are you referring to the permanent?
Let's talk about both, because I'm okay. Hearing something I'm not satisfied with.
Let me give you some clarity. When we complete, or any of the service line contractors complete their work at the house, we're responsible for maintaining any of the soft surface, hard surface, any of that, for 90 days. Is that correct?
Correct. So that's okay. The limestone and soil.
So 90 days. So we maintain the site to make sure there aren't sinkholes or things of that nature. After those 90 days, it's turned over to the city, and then the city is responsible for sending that to the restoration contractor, which happens to be us. So as soon as we get, as soon as the restoration contractor, which is us, gets the address, then we take responsibility for that.
So after 90 days, where if this season in November, December, January, February, after February, you call the city and they call you back in and you got a responsibility to show up, because normally some of this stuff is a year, 2 years in contracts. This short 90-day thing, yep. I want it to change.
So we do have a year.
So I'd like to make a referral to the administration that this 90-day clause need to be a year or two,
so
because we can't be responsible for fixing contractors' work. Proceed.
Yep, Councilman Mays. So we do have a year warranty on our service line work, and that is effectively, if you got a leak or something in the pipe, we got a year warranty.
Restoration.
Yep. Okay, so once that's turned over, the restoration contract is totally separate, and it's almost easier to talk about this if we're talking about a contractor other than Goyette that did the service line work.
Well, so, I know I got a repair and a damage claim with Goyette over in the 6th Ward. You familiar with it, Audrey, and okay. I like Audrey. So I know where some of y'all fans are setting that from a carpet that was wet, carpet replacement, about $1,300, $1,500 damage claim we looking at.
Okay.
We might pay $250. So if that warranty is a year, we're going to have to talk about it.
Yep.
But that's my concern. I want to make sure that in these contracts we put in the right amount of time on restoration as well as service lines. If not, our phone going to be ringing off the hook, and damage claims is going to be filed, and all contractors going to be gone. You follow me, Ms. Galloway? So I've made that referral to look close at that in phase 6 without objections. I would ask that be so sent. Proceed.
I agree with you, Councilman Mays, that there shouldn't be any holes in the warranty period that a resident should suffer as a result of, and there really aren't. If we have any defective workmanship from a replacement standpoint, like if we didn't seal a wall correctly, for example, or a floor from where we penetrated the wall or the floor when we brought the line in, if we didn't seal that and there's carpet damage or anything of that nature, that falls under that one-year warranty. So that won't be reflective on the restoration contractor unless they had some faulty workmanship that caused some issues. So essentially there is a one-year warranty for any workmanship issues that would fall on the service line contractor.
So what is retainage?
What is the retainage?
Yeah.
There's a 10% retainage withheld.
By the city?
By the city.
Okay, so we can go in that and replace somebody's carpet, huh? We'll see. But the point is this.
Or typically, I mean, we,
yeah,
as a contractor.
Yeah, because the address I'm referring to, it went through the wall. I prefer under the floor, but you know that's a contractor
sure.
philosophy, Mr. Davis. If you go through the wall, some people believe water eventually, if it ain't sealed right, can you get in them holes in the bricks, you know, them block bricks, and later on, 2-3 years, you have a problem. But if you go under the flow, you know, water goes straight down and you might not. So that's a philosophical. We'll find out. We'll keep our ears open, but we better continue to look at this. I've had experience with you, Mr. Parks, and you have been responsive to folks' calls.
Yes, sir.
Did you go through all of the figures? I know Mr. Guerra was moving you along. Is it more figures and cost? Is, you know, we're going to probably keep you continued as a witness. We gonna get out of here shortly, but proceed, counsel and witness for now, both witnesses, with anything you need to say or do. And the last thing we'll do is vote on the next meeting and who we might ask to be subpoenaed. Proceed, Mr. Parks.
I don't have anything to add to for counsel right now. I think thank you, Councilman Guerra, for referring AECOM's opinion. I think that will really help to move this ball down the road. We've been waiting for that since June. So anything that can be done to just get some two-way dialogue on this.
Yeah, I can appreciate what Mr. Guerra has did to facilitate that, but I can also appreciate your words as it relates to the decisions that the administration made as it relates to a bigger whole. Mm-hmm. You also talked about an agreement with, you know, certain things. And so that's what I look at, Mr. Davis. As long as we can help facilitate settlements, phase five overall, how would you grade phase five? You two. Because you were in phase four.
We were.
So compare phase four to phase five, and then tell me what you want phase six to look like.
So from Goyette's standpoint, we were awarded two zones, and our productivity has been fair, has been good.
How many zones did you bid on?
We bid on 10 zones.
I knew you did. They the bid big on 10 shots. Zones. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. Our progress has been good. We've had a good working relationship with the city. We value our relationship with the city. There's just these two little issues, two big issues that we'd like to get behind us. I would grade it as well. The project has gone well.
Successful.
So has been successful, and that includes the restoration contract as well. It appears that the other contractors, the service line contractors, are doing an excellent job as well. We're happy with our relationship with AECOM. Things from our standpoint as a replacement contractor, it's been a good project. We were in an area that didn't have a lot of replacements. We dug and found a lot of copper services, and depending on how you look at that, is that a good or a bad thing? As far as I'm concerned, it's a good thing. I would say that this has been a successful year for Goyette, for the project in general, and
no
we're
regret.
Just happy to be a part of the team.
No regrets on bidding.
No, we're happy to be a part of the team.
And you'll bid again in phase six, you think?
Our expectation is that we will probably bid whatever service line replacement work the city puts out.
Well, that's good. We appreciate you in the city of Flint and what you do and hopefully continue to do. It was something that I was going to ask as it relates to the other contractors, Goyette. As you was talking and I was being polite listening, I kind of lost my thought. But what I'm concerned about and what I'm interested in is, so you might have the restoration carryover. You might rebid the service lines. These outstanding proposed cost is what'll kind of end that financial aspect of phase five, and the total cost, even though we had some itemized breakdown, President Winfrey, whatever, the total cost was what again?
For the extras?
Yeah.
Our total costs for extras right now is at $706,938.
$706,000. Okay.
And that's through the 20th.
And them two areas was the main two areas. Those two areas that was talked about by President Winfrey.
Zones 9 and 10, yep.
Them the main two areas. Anything else from these folks? Can we ask you? Go ahead, Mr.
Yeah,
President.
Before you leave, I have a number that I really want you to get in contact with.
Oh, yes, sir.
Ms. Henderson. Right.
Is that the one we were talking about? Yeah, but at this point, you know, $1,300 or $1,500 for some carpet, I don't know if that's going to work. We'll see. We've been talking, but I don't want to have to pay nothing out of my pocket, but I want y'all to take a look at that. And, y'all went back and patched a hole in the wall. They don't want me to tell y'all that y'all left some fans there, but I say we'll make sure we keep them Goyette fans there, so if too much time passed, they will know they were really there and we didn't make this up. I say I need them fans, but we'll talk about it.
Sure.
And so I'm talking about it, and we'll get that communicated, because it's Miss President Winfrey's ward. but I done heard the lady sing in church at Mount Care. They sang pretty good, her and her sister, so I know them and they called me. So we'll talk about it and see what happens between the money that we hold back, that 10%, between whatever y'all decide, and I don't know. I think we had a good conversation today.
Sure, and if there's any issues with our workmanship on anything, we're always happy to work with residents and take care of them. We do a lot more than just replace service lines in this city. We replace water heaters and install furnaces and air conditioners, and the last thing we want is somebody to be unhappy as a result of some work that we did at their home, because this is the best advertising we could have for our other services that we provide. So I don't want her there in her neighborhood upset about some work that we did. And so I'm happy to speak with her and take care of whatever issues she has.
And I've had these good experiences with various contractors, and it helps keep a smile on Miss Wheeler's face and Mr. Winfrey. So I'm glad I brought it up. I'll try to be open and transparent as we try to get stuff done. Mr. Parks and ma'am, what was your name?
Kimberly Warner.
Ms. Warner, is it anything you need to add or let us know before we ask that y'all be continued? You don't necessarily have to be here or keep up. I'll call Mr. Parks if need be, but I would ask that your witness aspect be continued, you're under oath, and if you stay available, we will work with you as you work with us. Mr. Guerra is probably, well, this is his first term. He made history as a young council person, but he's sure catching on fast because talk is cheap, and he's turning it into action. And so I like an action-type council person. So I believe with the moves that Mr. Gare and this council is making and the relationship we have communicating with AECOM and the administration, hopefully we'll amicably end phase five. Thank you for now, and you may be excused.
Thank you, Council.
Thank you.
Mr. President, is it something? Mr. Parks, he don't want you to leave.
I'm gonna come
but
see you.
He wanna talk to you. But now I wanna do this last bit of business. Ms. Wheeler, I appreciate you. You done got my friend playing tag team, Mr. Attorney Millhouse. What I wanna do now is entertain some motions. And I wanna entertain a motion to subpoena two or three more witnesses. And we can take them one by one in a group. But that, Mr. Guerra.
Have you sent them a letter asking them to come in? My concern is subpoenaing somebody before we've asked them.
No, I've talked to the Attorney General's office. We've received communications. They don't believe that state folks have to come. And so these group of folks will be state folks who don't seem to be cooperating through their attorney.
And for me, I would like to still send a letter before we subpoena them.
I have no objection to that. If you want our staff to send a letter to Eric Pocan, Rich Baird, Governor Snyder's office, Harvey Hollins, I've got no problem with it. But let's go with three. Let's go with Eric Pocan, Rich Baird, the governor's office, the governor himself. Because I want to contact them and make contact with them. But Mr. Guerra, I'm still going to ask that subpoenas be issued, because you can send a letter, but when the attorney is telling you, we don't think we have to show for you, you better save some time before the end of this year and move on it. And then win, lose, or draw, all this stuff is in the proceeding with Amy Epke, is my thoughts. So I would order that we do the emails or letter or make preliminary contact, and I would order that without objection for those three witnesses. Any other witnesses? Now, I do anticipate we'll be talking to the mayor, Mr. Gilchrist, but I don't think we're going to have to subpoena do so. We dealing with the state and city, and we'll get there, but I'm looking at the city as the state is the one that's being a little more. Now, should we call Mr. Ananick or Neely near me or them people who y'all know any requests? Because I know two requests I got. I want to send an email also to the appropriations chair for the House and the Senate. The appropriations chair for the House and the Senate, and I'm going to request them and or their staff to show up and communicate. As we went down this process earlier, when I was had to go talk to them at the Michigan Municipal League gathering, when we broke away and went and talked under the old council, when you're dealing with money flowing from Lansing, and remember, 227 or so of that $500 million is state appropriations. Mm-hmm. So you want to talk to the Senate and House appropriation chairs and or their staff. So I would ask that that email also go out and request to them. Some of those folks won't be leaving between now and January. But some of them staff people, Mr. Guerra, sent that out with no objections, but I still want to move and serve them in a timely manner. And I would premise that on what the attorney is saying. He don't just speak for Amy Epke. He's speaking for state folks. Mm-hmm. We're okay with that? You ain't mad at me. All right. Any more discussion or communication? Any witnesses that a council person want lined up or communicated with, just let me and or the staff know. If the staff let me know, if you don't call me, I mean, we've got an open hearing. It's a good exercise, and it needs to happen. So if we're going to communicate with those folks by email, we got one little caveat. When would we meet again, if ever?
That was getting ready to be my question.
Mr. President, you got any suggestions? Look like we're traveling with a five-member quorum. Y'all can't work on your colleagues. Is this intentional, unintentional? Is it a scheduling conflict?
Well, Councilwoman Fields told me she would be here. So okay. I don't know what happened.
Something might have come up. Here. Okay, so well, that's good. It ain't no boycott or nothing.
No, she told me she would
well,
be
here. Well, that's a blessing. Yeah. Okay, so we'll continue to move forward. The holidays is coming up.
I would like to, I think we should meet one more time before the holidays, at least one
at
more.
At least one more. Yeah. I like that word, at least. When? Beg your pardon?
I don't have my schedule on me.
I know you're a busy millennial.
Centennial.
Is that younger than a millennial? So when I say millennial, that's giving you too much age. So centennial. I really apologize.
He's a linkster.
He's a what?
Linkster.
So let's look at what's the day. The day
today
is Wednesday.
The 28th.
Next Wednesday we got committee.
Committees,
meeting,
right?
Ms. Brown.
Yes, if I could. Just kind of looking at government as a whole. The first 2 weeks in December, I would say anything after the 14th of December is probably persona non grata for a lot of people. Anything after the 14th of December
is not.
It would be out.
Right. Persona non grata.
Yes, I do.
Anything after the 14th. In other words, anything after the 14th would be kind of like out of the question.
Out of question.
Because
off
of the
limits.
Holidays.
Right.
So we would have to look at the first. I think the first couple of weeks in December, starting the week of December 3rd, and then of course the week of December 10th.
That's what I'm thinking.
Right. After that, it's kind of
mornings, afternoon, or evening.
I think mornings are better.
Mornings, Mr. Guerra.
Yeah.
10 o'clock, Ms. Galloway, Mr. Davis. A Monday or Wednesday, you thinking?
No Monday.
Wednesday.
Wednesday seem to be good.
Wednesday, 10 o'clock. What would be the next Wednesday?
That would be the 5th of December. And then after that, the 12th of December.
Yeah, we got committees that evening, but that morning at 10, you say you won't?
I'm available.
We might not get a quorum then.
So that's the 5th.
What you thinking? You'll be in Florida.
What about the 12th then?
It's wintertime. People be in Florida in the wintertime. No, I'm just kidding. So the 12th?
That would be the following Wednesday.
10 o'clock. Let's do it.
The president, is that a motion?
I would like to put that in the form of a motion.
So it's been moved that we reconvene on
December 12th.
December the 12th at 10 a.m. And it's been properly seconded by Mr. Guerra. Any discussion? I would say this, as we continue to deal with the courts and the enforcement of subpoenas, as these letters go out to the potential folks to show up on the 12th, who I don't expect, Mr. Guerra, and to this council, if I communicate with legal and we send in letters and subpoenas at the same time, everybody understand the logic. Okay, and then what will happen is we will see what we get in folks' hands prior to January. I don't want folks leaving out and then we don't even have a chance to get them. So I'll look at the total witness list as it relates to what we did in the first meeting, and if y'all allow me, I'll work to get stuff done. Okay. And we'll continue to have things going. And at any time you feel things is going a certain way or not going a certain way, we can entertain a motion to proceed or discontinue this investigative hearing. All right, any more discussion on the motion? Roll call, Madam Clerk.
This is on the motion for the date, right?
For the date.
December the 12th at 10 a.m.
Yeah, and the communications will go out. Sure. And this would be for December 12th at 10 a.m.
Mr. Mays?
Yes.
Mr. Davis?
Yes.
Mr. Guerra?
Yes.
Mr. Winfrey?
Yes.
Ms. Galloway?
Yes.
Okay. Vote is 5 yes, 0 no. December 12th, 2018 at 10 a.m.
Okay, any other pertinent discussion? If not, then I would entertain a motion to recess until...
Did you want to do the motion on the letters to be sent out?
The letters to be sent out, I think we've ordered that without objection.
Without objection.
Okay. Right. All right.
And any subpoenas or communications in addition to that, we'll be communicating, and that's allowed without objection. And so all of that is so ordered. And anything anybody need in the interim, you know, let me know, and I'll try to assist if you can't do it on your own. But I think we're doing good so far, and we're nipping at it. And at some point, it'll speed up, and
we'll
close out. If there's no other discussion, I would entertain a motion to recess until December 12th. At 10 a.m. this investigative hearing. Mr. Guerra?
So moved.
Mr. President?
I support the motion.
So it's been moved and properly seconded that we recess until December 12th, this investigative hearing, and to 10 a.m. Any more discussion or any discussion if it's allowed? If not, roll call, Madam Clerk.
Mr. Davis?
Yes.
Mr. Guerra?
Yes.
Mr. Winfrey?
Yes.
Ms. Galloway?
Yes.
Mr. Mays?
Yes.
Okay, the vote is 5 yes, 0 no.
We are in recess.